In 1996, two scientists shared the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine for discoveries into how the immune system recognizes and responds to virus-infected cells. Peter C. Doherty, Ph.D. of St. Jude, and Rolf M. Zinkernagel, M.D. Ph.D. of the University of Zurich, were honored for research done in the early 1970s when they were young investigators sharing laboratory space and puzzling over viral immunity. 20 years later, Dr. Doherty talks with Dr. Paul Thomas, associate member of St. Jude Immunology, about that day and how science has progressed.
Why don't you start out by telling us, in your own words, what you won the prize for?
We won the prize. Rolf and I won it for discovering how the hitmen of the immune system work. These are the white blood cells that go around the body and circulate, and then if they find damaged cells, that are damaged as a consequence of virus infection, or in some cases, in some cancers, they bump them off. And we worked out the basis of how that recognition is targeted to the surface of the cell, and with the speculations at that time, because we couldn't do a lot of the experiments because the technology just wasn't there, we came to some rather good guesses about the whole thing works. And as a result of that, we got the Nobel Prize something like 20 years later.
So at the time, you know, people knew that these transplant antigens existed and that virus-infected cells were killed. What were the competing theories for what role those molecules played?
These transplant molecules, rather than defining that something's foreign from another individual, they actually define us. They define self. And the whole debate of immunology since the turn of the 19th, 20th century has been about what we call self-non-self discrimination. And we discovered that this apparent non-self is actually the definition of self, and by changing it, we make our own cells that need to be eliminated look as though they're foreign. And a lot of people were interested and fascinated by it, but the explanation we came up with, that a single T-cell receptor sees what we called altered self, was not accepted, I think, by the majority of the community in immunology. And then, so that was controversial, it went backwards and forwards for years, and then 10 years later, as the technology improved, and advances in science are often dictated by improvements in the techniques and the methods and the instrumentation that we've got, and that's why science has gone ahead so rapidly over the last few years, because we've had these enormous advances in those areas. As the technology advanced, then the actual molecules that were involved in this whole process became clear, and that was from the work of others. And so one of the principles about winning the Nobel Prize is you make the initial discovery, and then a lot of other people work on it, and then you get the Nobel Prize.
You eventually started working in the U.S. And eventually found your way to St. Jude. How did the sort of those early discoveries shape the rest?
So I spent about 10 years learning what I was doing. Then we made this big discovery. And then I spent about the next 20 years as a fairly prominent figure in the field of immunology, you know, up there with the people who are asked to speak at conferences. And so constantly going to conferences and talking and doing experiments and writing grants and what everyone does in science. And then came to St. Jude in 1988, which is one of the really best things I've ever done, because it's a great institution, a fantastic place to work. Tiny place then, only about 800 people. Mm. Now it's more than 4,000?
Almost 5,000, right?
Almost 5,000, yeah. So it's massively different from what it was when I first came, and of course it's all been going forward. So then that's followed by another 20 years, because it's 20 years since the Nobel Prize, which I would describe as still being involved in a lot of very good science because of some technological changes that happened, but it's a somewhat confused time because suddenly you're not just a scientist, you're kind of a spokesman for science, you've got other roles to play, and I've been trying to speak up for science, and I've written some books for lay people about science, and I've just tried to talk about science generally and the importance of looking at evidence, and just how well that's gone, I'm not too sure, but we'll see where it goes in the long term.
Looking forward for, you know, the next 10 years of science, what do you think are the big challenges that we're facing as a field, particularly in immunology?
The challenges with biomedical science in general are, at the moment, we simply are overwhelmed with an enormous amount of information and data. With modern technology, we can read out every gene that's being expressed in a particular disease situation. We've been doing some of that work at St. Jude with array-type technologies and so forth. We've got all this information. We have all sorts of possibilities that look as though they'd be worth following up. And it's a question of how much you focus and where you actually go. But there are enormous advances, really. I think one of the big advances in immunology, I mean, the one advance that came sort of through the theme that we were following, the killer T cells, are the new anti-cancer therapies pioneered by Jim Allison. These immune checkpoint inhibitor drugs that allow these killer T cells, which we knew were sitting around a lot of cancers but not doing anything. And we knew that for years, and we've been trying to wake them up, and people have been taking them out of the body and growing them up and then injecting them back in. And apart from some work at St. Jude, in fact, with virus-specific killer T cells that are specific for a virus-induced cancer caused by Epstein-Barr virus, there wasn't much success. But Jim Allison worked out how to wake them up again, and they've been bumping off a lot of tumors and saving a lot of lives. And so that's been very impressive. But I think if I look at immunology itself, the immune system, the host response that deals with pathogens, I think a lot of the real advances are going to be in understanding with modern technology what's actually happening in the disease process, the pathology as we call it. And it won't be so much treating the infection, but trying to moderate some of the responses that we make in order to repair our tissues and get rid of the bug. And if we make them too strongly, we can actually do ourselves a lot of damage. And if we can get that right and get a good balance so that we cure the infection, but at the same time allow ourselves to recover without doing ourselves too much damage, then I think that would be a big advance in actual treatment and therapy.
Since most of us are not going to win a Nobel Prize, you can talk about some of the practical aspects of it. How did you find out, and what was that like?
We got a call at 4 in the morning, and my wife picks up the telephone. We're living in Memphis, in Midtown Memphis, and a voice says, "This is Nils Ringerts from the Nobel Foundation." And of course, we were scared because we had relatives back in Australia, and we thought something's gone wrong with the family. I mean, you don't normally get calls at 4 in the morning. But the guy said it was from the Nobel Foundation, so she said, "This is for you," and gave me the phone. So that was it. And then they said, "Well, you've got 10 minutes to..." The reason it was 4 in the morning is because the Europe is ahead of us, and the committee had met, and they'd presented the case to the professors at the Karolinska Institute Medical School who make the final decision, and they'd all said yes. And so the decision had been made, but they weren't announcing it to the press for 10 minutes. They said, "You've got 10 minutes to let people know, and then your world will go crazy because your phone will ring constantly." So I think we called our two sons, and we woke up Jerry Chipman, who was at that stage running the communications publicity side for St. Jude, and woke him up, and he organized to get the calls routed somewhere else after a while, and started to do the publicity stuff. But we knew, I'd always wondered how we'd know that it wasn't a hoax, because I had people in the lab who were perfectly capable of faking a Swedish accent and doing something like that. But we knew it wasn't immediately, because we're getting called from Reuters and Talkback Radio and Bogota, Colombia. And
the lab just could have been very ambitious about it.
They're not that inventive. not at 4 in the morning. Yeah, no, you might get one postdoc if you wake up at 4 in the morning, but not a whole lab. Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Peter. This has been very helpful.
Thanks.